This is actually going to fit in really nicely with what Michael was talking about. So, what do clouds and castles and wheat have in common? Let's start with the wheat. So we work at the John Innes Centre, and we study plants and also how they interact with microbes. And wheat is a really important plant. It's one of the plants we study most because it provides about 20% of the calories daily for everybody everywhere. So it's feeding the equivalent of well over a billion people a day. And one of the ways in which we study wheat is we grow lots of different varieties of wheat, different genotypes, and we see how they differ developmentally. And that's what you're seeing here, a picture of our field trials plots with lots of wheat plants. And the trouble with this image is that it's not very good for doing analysis. You can't see the back plots very well, you get lots of view of the front plots. So we can do better. We can fly a drone over the field trials plots and see more of them at once. So we get an image like this, where you can see the individual sets of plants more clearly. And then what we actually want out of this is numbers, we want data. So where we in the scientific computing group at the John Innes Centre come in is to take images like this one and do some analysis on them. And we also work with microscopy data as well, so not just things like drone images. So we'll write some kind of code that will do something like take each plot image and try to segment it, so pick out the individual subplots of the image, and then do some analysis on this side, perhaps to look at colour or amount of greenness, and then turn those into numbers that the experimental biologists are interested in, so we see how differently the plants grow. And we tend to develop these analyses on standard laptops, like the one I'm presenting on, like the one I can see lots of in the audience. We work on small sample data sets. It's useful to be able to work on something portable. We can iterate rapidly, test out lots of things, see what works. We work with experimental biologists, explosions. So these are some of our experimental biologists looking at plants. And very often they will want to run the analysis that we develop, because they don't want to have to wait for us. They want to get their data out of the microscope, quickly run the code, see what results they get. So we want to be able to take our code, which we've written on, say, a OSX Mac laptop, give it to them. They often have cheap Windows desktops, because they have to spend their money on microscopes and nets and things. So we've got a cross operating system divided here. And then there's another problem to do with scaling. So we take our single image, we work on sample data sets, but actually I've only shown you part of our whole set of field trials plots, which looks like this. So quite a figure, single image is one of 60, and this is actually multiple time points in this data series. So there's a lot of work to do here, and processing that single image we saw before on my laptop takes a few minutes. And because there's about 300 images in these series, I don't want to surrender my laptop for hours to days to process all of this. And also, again, if I want to iterate quickly on the whole data set, I want to do better. So, fortunately for this purpose, we have an HPC cluster. It's good, quite shiny, it's got blinky lights, sorry, that's good. Unfortunately, our data center likes the flood. Not quite this badly, but badly enough to put it out of action every so often. Plus it has power problems, and sometimes it's just so busy because we'll be able to do bioinformatics on it that we can't run on it. And at that point, it would be really nice to be able to use cloud infrastructure. It's sort of, in a sense, a disaster recovery all for first, into something like Amazon Two or Google Compute. So this is one of our core problems. We want to be able to take the code from the laptop, run it on Windows desktop, HPC cloud. How easy is this? Well, we'll take the first problem, which is, in a sense, the simplest, so let's give it to our friendly biologists. What do we need to do to do that? Well, we wrote the code in Python, so all we need to do is give them our Python script. and they'll need the live viewing rate to deal with biological images more easily. And that depends on another library, because you can write everything from scratch, which we're not saying. And actually that relies on some lower level libraries, which you might recognize. And those need some system support from other libraries. And if you want to get microscope data into this thing, you're going to need some extra software, because instrument manufacturers hate standards. That's my only explanation. And that needs Java for support. And you probably need at least a C compiler to get all of this going. And at this point, our friendly biologists are no longer friendly. They're running away screaming because they've got 10 pages of installation instructions. What about the cluster? Well, on the cluster, things get worse. Because if you've ever worked on a sort of traditionally managed compute cluster, as I'm sure a lot of you have, you will know that this is basically computing for Puritans. On the cluster, you can't have package managers. Package managers are the devil's work. And so is Git, you've got these Git remotes, and so are installation scripts, and so are any build systems that are less than 30 years old. So, on the cluster, you work the way you're intended. You build your software from scratch with a toothpick and a Stephen pipe. So there we are, compiling libjpeg in what feels like a 50th time to get our software stack working. When we realize it feels a lot like building modern software stacks is like building castles. You start with a base level, that's your operating system. You build on some low-level system libraries that everything else you're going to need. You can pop on interpreters, things like Perl and Python, because you'll probably need those. Then you've got some extra system binaries you'll need to support. Often things want databases, and they want JavaScript pretty front-ends. And some of the castles are kind of solid, stable castles, and they're made from C and Fortran, and not too complicated. Some of them are sort of old and crumbly, and made from Perl and PHP and Pol, CGI script and things. And some of them are kind of needlessly complicated baroque castles, full of Pascal and Rust and NoSQL, because that can be. But they've got something in common. They're big, they're solid, they're not going anywhere. If you want a castle somewhere else, if you want your infrastructure, your software infrastructure somewhere else, you're going to build it again. This is not what we want. But there's another type of castle, and it's a castle that appears, it appeared first in a children's novel by an author called Lionel and James, and then later in a movie from Studio Ghibli, an adaptation of the novel. And this is a castle that moves. It's called Howl's Moving Castle, because Howl's the character in the novel. And this is what we want. This is a castle that can build it, can pick itself up, but it can walk to where you want to go. This is a kind of our dream for our software infrastructure. How do we get there? Well, we do what any sensible set of kind of rational scientific people do in this situation. We get on our knees and we pray to the infrastructure angels. And the infrastructure angels heard our prayers and they brought Docker. And you've heard a lot about Docker. We'll hear a lot more about Docker. It's great. It solves a lot of our problems. It lets us take our castle building on the laptop, move it to our Windows desktops and the cloud. What about the HPC? So Michael has foreshadowed the conversation that we had with the industry. So it flashed with enthusiasm about how great Docker was, how it would solve all of these problems. He wouldn't spend hours building software anymore. We ran to our friendly cluster system administrators. And we said, can you install Docker for us? And they said, do we need to know anything about it? And he said, maybe not. And we said, are you sure? And we said, okay, maybe. And he said, are you sure? And we said, well, the Docker team needs to run as root, and anyone that can run a container can be root, so everyone can be root anywhere in the cluster. Then there was a pause. And we found out that the reason we get so many floods in the data center is because they keep a water cannon behind the door for when we come around with bright ideas about infrastructure. So, back to the infrastructure angels. Docker, great, it solves a lot of our problems, but not all of them. So they went back, and they came away, and they brought Singularity. And you just heard about how great Singularity is, and all I can add is, it's that great plus even more. It's fantastic. Solves many of our problems, everything's great, we can go off into the sunset, our infrastructure moves with us, we build it in Docker and Singularity. Not quite. So, these are fantastic tools, but there are still some gaps. Gap one. experimental biologists. Now they're happy because they don't have to spend 10 hours compiling it, making it by hand. We can give them a container and tell them to run the container. When we tell them to run the container, what is that going to look like? It's going to look like this. They've got to type this, they've got to get it right, there's no line breaks here, just put it on my slide you can see, and they've got to know where their data is, and they've got to know how to address it inside the container and outside the container. And they're then rapidly back to being not very happy biologists again. Another problem, and actually this is sort of what we're talking about in the question answer before, we've got to build these things. It's great that we can build them from control file scripts, so either Docker files or singularity build equivalent. But we kind of need both, because we need Docker, because it's much, much easier to use on desktops, laptops. But we also want singularity for cluster. So then we've got two options. Exactly this point came up in the questions. Do we convert the Docker images? Do we convert the Docker build files? Do we build singularity from scratch? We've gone with Docker as our kind of canonical format, and then we convert the images, but that's got upsides and downsides. One of the downsides is you're leaving the ampersand here for doing this a lot. Another problem, so in the bad old days, when we didn't know about containers, we had conversations about like this. Okay? You do this analysis, you get your results. Was it version 2.2.8 or probably last in this case, with version numbering, some other tool? Was it a different version? You need to know because it's going to affect the results. Now we live in the bright, shiny, wonderful future where containers will let us in. We don't have to have this conversation anymore. It's great. Instead, we have this conversation. Which of these hashes ran your container? We can sort of solve this. We can link this back to, say, commit hashes for a particular version of the build script. Although then, if those are pulling in other bits of software, it's not quite that simple. Or we can archive whole images, but that's a problem too. Another problem, this is more sort of workflow-ish, that containers don't solve by themselves. We really want to be able to take sections of our large data set and say, okay, this section goes to this node, and this section goes to this node, and this section goes to this node. We've got to do that somehow. And then another problem, again, this actually has come up in the questions, and this is a bit sort of philosophical between the two approaches. Let's illustrate this. So, we have a piece of bioinformatics software from Healthy Helmet. It's not ours, somebody else wrote it, but it's a good example because it was an early test case for us for singularity. And it does something to do with population genetics. If you compile this the old-fashioned way, so GCC and Prusik approach, you get a binary that's about 874 kilobytes big. It's dynamically linked, so this is realistically a bit bigger than this with all the stuff you need to run it. Somebody on our cluster built a singularity image. Before I do that, this is a sort of representation, a size representation of how much space this is taking up. They got a singularity image of this. Great, it contains everything you need to know to run it, including the things to which this would be linked, and the operating system, other things like that. It's now 4.1 gigabytes. It's 4 million kilobytes. It doesn't really need to be this big. This is partly because how they set the space constraints, but it still is going to be a lot bigger. If we use the same sort of scheme for container size, then you know, the center's over here somewhere, this thing is so big that light walks around, maybe why it's called singularity. This is this trade-off between do you have layered file systems, which is great for space constraints, but it is bad for portability and potentially archiving, or do you put everything in one box? And again, somebody suggested, again, during questions and answers, if you put these things on a deduplicating file system, would it help? And actually, we have started to do this, and yes, it does. You're moving potentially problems to your file system instead, but maybe you trust your file system more. So that's partly how we're solving this. The other way we solve this is that in bioinformatics, people will cheerfully take a 2 terabyte data set, duplicate it all over their file space, so they've got, you know, 20 terabytes of the same data. And at that point, this looks like small change. So really the work we've been doing into sort of helping containers work for us is to try and translate the semantic concept, which is I want to take my code, I want to run that particular version of the code on my data set. To do that, you need something which is going to understand a version of the code and build the container somehow. You need something that's going to understand what you mean by your data, so you need the data set. And then once you know where you're running it, what your local infrastructure is, it can turn that into a set of jobs, commands, whatever execution scripts to run on that infrastructure. And we've been working on some tools to do this. We've got something at the end of the go button, because it's easier than having to worry about exactly how we run these. Something for this, which is called dtool, which manages the data, so that's also useful for a lot of other contexts. Something to do this process of dividing the work into jobs is a little bit more difficult. We have Gary button, which sounds a little bit like Richard Martouris's HPC command. It's sort of wrapping some of these invocation scripts. And then something to do this build process, which is not really nice at the moment, it's collection hashing scripts. But we're roughly at the point where, under the right circumstances at least, we can now start to define these things rather than have to have versions of software. We can say our analysis code is a particular commit in a repository, just a repository link that we can also identify by commit as well. We point our data, say that we want the outputs, and then we have a very, very simple command, this is easy to run it. So we're kind of we're getting towards that dream state where our car sort of flies over our fields and we solve the infrastructure problem. But really, I guess the takeaway message is that the containers are fantastic, the technology is really great, especially singularities, but there's still lots of glue work to do around the edges, which I think is where a lot of the effort is going. I've been hearing that already today. So I'm keeping you back from lunch, so all I will do now is thank the people that made this possible. So that they are actually quite friendly here today, like this, our system administrators. The biologists at the GIC were fantastic people to work with, the rest of my team, who have made this possible, and Doc and Singularity for making the software that enables all of this. And thank you for watching.
Thank you.